Okay, so what I will be talking about is a popular framework for dealing with uncertainty in optimization called online framework. And in particular, I want to focus on a central problem in this area called the K-server problem, and present to you a new algorithm for this problem. And this algorithm is joint work with Nikhil Bansal, Niv Bhupinda, and Sefi Nao.
Okay.
So the point of start of this talk is the classical view on optimization, okay? So according to the classical view, the way the optimization happens is that, if you have some problems you want to solve, then we are presented with an input instance of this problem. We put this instance in our computer, we run some algorithm on that, and this produces some answer. It might be an optimal answer or maybe only approximately optimal answer, okay? So, this is the way we think about optimization nowadays, and sort of this point of view was, is extremely influential in computer science and beyond it. But, the point I want to make today is that, despite all of its success and its influence, there is one aspect of, quite a fraction of real-world problems that this framework, completely misses, is that it's not present in this view. And, this aspect is the fact that, uncertainty is a part of life, and then as a result, it's just a part of many optimization problems. So to give you an example, imagine that you are a, trader at Wall Street, and your task is to sell and buy stocks to maximize profit, and if you look at the stock quotes from last month, it's very easy for you to see, which stocks you should sell and which one you should buy to maximize your profit. But that's not the core of the problem, because the core of the problem is that you have to do it for the next month. So you have to decide what to buy, what to sell, before you see the full impact of, of your decisions. So in particular, the common characteristic of the problem we try to capture here is that, we don't know the whole input in advance. We only learn it gradually. But still, as we learn this input, we already have to make some irrevocable decisions along the way. So, we have to make decisions, even though sometimes we cannot really evaluate what will be the impact on the performance of the final solution. Okay, so this is clearly an aspect of optimization that classical view does not capture. So, the question is, how can we capture this kind of challenges? How can we deal with that? Okay, so as you might imagine, this is not a new question, and there are already some well-known answers. In particular, there are two prevailing frameworks to kind of settle this kind of questions. So the first one is called, stochastic optimization. And what this framework tells us is, the following, that, okay, you don't know what your input will be, really, but you at least know that it will be coming from some, underlying distribution. And furthermore, you actually know what the distribution will be. So, all you have to do is just devise a procedure that, will leverage this knowledge of this distribution to make sure that you will try to, optimize your expected cost with respect to the distribution. Okay? So this is the framework, and the nice thing about this framework is that, quite often it allows you to get a positive results that, that give you a performance guarantee that is very close to what you will be able to do if there was no uncertainty involved at all. Okay? So that's a nice thing, but the problem is that, it's not really clear how meaningful this kind of positive results are, because if you have your problem, how do you know that, the input you are seeing comes from some fixed distribution? And even if this distribution exists, how can you access it? How can you tell us, that you will know what it exactly is? So this is the problem, and this problem brings us to the second framework for dealing with uncertainty optimization called online optimization. So what this framework does, it takes exactly the opposite stance. So what it tells you is that, you make absolutely no assumptions on, how your input will look like. Yes, it can be even adversarial, and, really it can be as bad as possible, and your task is, to be able to still optimize the worst case cost of the solution. Yes? So there is no notion of expectation because you don't know what is the distribution. So you really try to, optimize the worst case here. So, so clearly, the problem here is that, once you are in such a restrictive setting, then, more often than not, you will end up having not a positive result, but negative results, and pretty strong at that. But, on the flip side of this is, if you are able to get some positive result, then this is an extremely meaningful statement, yes, because it just holds without any assumptions and you don't have to worry about, how it's applicable to your particular problem. So, As you might guess from the title of the talk, you know, the framework I want to focus on today is online optimization framework. And in particular, let's start by discussing one of the classical problems in the area, namely the caching problem. Okay? So the caching problem tries to, you know, tries to capture the difficulty of maintaining a cache in a situation where the data access, data access patterns are unknown to us. So, you know, probably all of you know, but you know, caching is a very popular technique for speeding up memory access in a situation when the memory has very large latency. So what you are trying to do, you know, whenever you fetch some data from the memory, you try to store it locally in your cache. So whenever you need it again, you can quickly access it. But of course, the catch here is that cache has only limited size, and you cannot just afford to simply store everything you ever fetch. So you have just to, well, to make sure that you keep the most important stuff. But now, if you don't know what the data access memory pattern is, well, it's hard for you to assess what is the important stuff really. So there is some difficulty coming in, and you know, this problem tries to capture exactly that. So formally, the way we do it is as follows. So the setup here is that, you know, we have our, you know, we have a universe of n pages. So these are the, you know, we can at most see n different pages throughout the execution of the algorithm. And we have a cache which can hold, you know, at any given time at most k pages. And to make this interesting, we assume that k is strictly smaller than n. Okay? So this is the setup, and now we are playing the following game. So in each round, we get a page request coming in, okay? And now two things can happen. So either we have already, we already have this page in the cache, and then we are happy because we can fetch it quickly and we don't have to do anything. Or, we are slightly more unlucky, and the page that is requested actually is not in our cache. And, then we have a cache miss. And what we have to do, first of all, we have to fetch this page, from the memory. And also now we want to, you know, to put it in our cache. And, you know, if we have a room in this cache to put this page, then that's all we have to do. But sometimes, you know, the cache might be full already, so we have to decide which page to evict to make room for this new page. Okay? So this is the game we are playing, and this keeps repeating. And, you know, note that the only decision that we are making in this, you know, in this model is just, you know, which page to evict whenever we have to evict the page. Okay? So everything else is already predefined by the input. So now our goal is, you know, to devise an eviction policy that will lead to the minimal, you know, total number of cache misses over the sequence that we are presented with. Okay, so this is the problem, and you know, now once we know the problem, you know, you might actually wonder, you know, what do we actually mean by a good solution to it? Okay, so what are the good algorithms that we are looking for here? So you know, clearly, if we knew all the future requests in advance, then it's very easy to get an optimal solution. It's like there is a very simple policy that allows you to do that. But of course, you know, the point here is that that's not what we are after here. So we are trying to do well despite the fact that we have no idea what the future will be. So this is the online setting. And in particular, once you have no idea what is the future, then there is no hope really for always be able to match the offline optimum. So offline optimum is the best solution when you know the whole sequence of requests in advance. So you know, so we cannot hope to match the offline optimum. So what we are after here is to what we are after here is, you know, to design an online algorithm that tries to never do much worse than the offline optimum. Okay. So we don't hope to be always able to be optimal, but at least we want to be always sure that we are not far from the optimal solution. And you know, to make it precise, you know, we introduce the notion of competitiveness, and we say that the algorithm is, you know, C competitive for some value C if on every request sequence the number of cache misses that we suffer is never bigger than C times the optimal number of, you know, of cache misses that we could, you know, that we could have here. Okay, and you know, what we will be after, we'll be trying to find an algorithm who have, you know, minimal competitiveness. Okay, so now, you know, once we know, you know, I should also mention that, you know, competitiveness is only one measure of performance of the algorithm. There are also other measures that I will not talk about. You know, in particular, there is so-called, you know, minimal regret measurement, you know, but I will not go into that in this talk. So, okay, so now we know what we do, well, what we mean by you know, by a good algorithm. So you know, so what is known about, so how can you get some, you know, some nice algorithm for this problem? So you know, if you think about good algorithms for this problem, then probably one of the first reasonable approaches that you will find is so-called LRU policy in which you are, you know, evicting the page that is, you know, that was least recently used. Okay, and indeed, Sitter and Tarjan in their seminal paper they analyzed this policy and they proved that it is K competitive. Okay, so the statement that this is a K competitive is an interesting statement because, you know, note that the competitiveness does not depend on the length of the sequence. Okay, so the sequence can be very long, but this, you know, this sort of this competitiveness ratio depends only on the size of the cache. So that's very interesting. On the other hand, you know, if your cache has like 10,000 lines, then it's not, you know, it's not the most satisfying performance ever. So, you know, so the obvious question is, you know, can we do better than that? Okay? And Sitter and Tarjan thought about this question and they actually answered that no, you cannot beat this, you know, this factor of K, at least, you know, as long as your algorithm is deterministic. Okay? Sort of the, you know, the key reason why this is the case is that actually deterministic algorithms are completely predictable. So, you know, if you give me a, well, if you fix an algorithm and you, you know, and you look at any particular input sequence, then, you know, you are able to predict exactly what will be the state of the cache of the algorithm at every given time step. Okay, it's, everything is uniquely defined. So as a result, it is not hard to design a sequence that causes this algorithm to have a cache miss every single round. And then when you do, you know, appropriate math, you will notice that, you know, you can make the sequence that, you know, it will cause the algorithm to have a cache miss every single time, but the optimal solution will only have a cache miss at most every kth round. So this will lead to this k lower bound. Okay? So this is, you know, so this is a result. But of course, the natural question now is, you know, so how about randomness? Can randomness help here? And well, it turns out that it indeed can. So, no. So what we would like here, what we are considering here is, you know, we are thinking about eviction policies that can use, well, can make random choices. Yes. So what we do, well, our algorithm can, you know, can toss random coins. And what we are measuring for a given sequence is the expected number of cache misses. Okay. And once we look at this model and we give more power to our algorithm, then we could do much better. Actually exponentially better. In fact, you know, there is a very, you know, very simple algorithm that allows you to obtain O of log K competitiveness. And you can prove that this O of log K is actually the best possible here. So clearly for, you know, for caching problem, we essentially know everything. So we know the best competitiveness for, you know, for a randomized model and for deterministic model. So probably this is time to move to a slightly more challenging problem, namely the K-server problem, which will be the focus of the remainder of this talk. Okay? So, yeah, so probably, you know, the easiest way to think about the what, you know, what a K-server problem is to view it as a, you know, as a task of, you know, that a fire truck dispatcher is facing. Okay, so the setup here is that we have n locations over some metric, so, you know, there might be different distances between any two points. Okay, and we have K-servers of or fire trucks here. Okay, so and we want the number of servers to be well strictly smaller than the number of locations to make it interesting again. And now, you know, we are playing the following game. So in each round, we have a request or a fire appearing at one of the locations. And once again, one of two things can happen. So, you know, either, you know, well, we have a server or a fire truck, you know, at this location already. So, you know, so we are happy, well, modulo putting out the fire. Or actually, you know, we don't have a fire at this location. And then what has to happen is, well, we have to decide, you know, which of the servers or fire trucks to move to this location. Well, to take care of this of the fire. Okay, so here is the fire, and we move this truck, and there is another fire, and we move this truck. So, you know, so this is the game, and now, you know, our task is to devise a way of, you know, moving the servers around that will, you know, lead to the minimum total distance traveled by the by these fire trucks, you know, while serving the request. And of course, we want to do all of this in online settings, so in a setting when we don't know where the future fire will be. Okay, so this is the problem. And, you know, and now a good question is, you know, why do we even care about this problem? Okay, so what is the motivation for studying this kind of problem? And well, there are a couple of reasons for that. So one reason is that they actually, you know, this problem captures, well, even though it's very artificial and sort of very simple, or maybe maybe because of that, it captures quite a variety of online scenarios. So you can imagine, you know, the servers to be like technicians, service trucks, copies of frequently changing data, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, and each of these instantiations will, you know, will yield some interesting online scenario, and they all will be captured by this K-server problem. And in particular, you can view caching as a special case of the K-server problem. So essentially, caching is the case error problem on uniform metric. So to see why this is the case, you know, you just identify locations with pages, and you interpret the server location, having server location I, well, you interpret it as you have page I in your cache. And then it's easy to see that whenever you have a request, you know, it corresponds to, well, you can see it as a fire or as a request to a page, and this operation of moving the servers corresponds exactly to eviction and fetching procedure. And since the metric is uniform, you know, every such a move counts the same, so this will just count the number of cache misses while you are serving the request. Okay, so this is one type of reasons why we care about this problem, but also the second type of reason that makes this problem interesting, at least to me as a theoretician, is that despite the very simple formulation, this problem has extremely rich structure. So in particular, the more you look into this problem, you are realize that it seems to capture something about online optimization that we don't really understand, but we should understand. So that's another reason why we really want to understand what's going on in this problem. Okay, so now once we know what is the problem and why we might care about it, let's talk about what is known about this problem. So clearly, as caching is a special case of the case error problem, then all the lower bounds, transfer over. So we know that we cannot hope for a better than k-competitive, a deterministic algorithm and better than overflow k-competitive randomized algorithm, okay? And the interesting thing is that, despite the fact that the case error problem seems to be much, much, much more general than that, we don't know any single better lower bound. So all the lower bounds for this problem come directly from the lower bounds for the caching problem, okay? So this is, these people were quite surprised by that and, they couldn't believe at first. But then, this state of the affairs made them, put quite a bold conjecture. So, okay, so if we cannot prove better lower bounds than we have for caching, so, well, maybe, maybe these are actually the right bounds here. So maybe, we can, these bounds are actually tight and, and this question has, two versions. So one is deterministic case error conjecture, which asks about exactly k-competitive deterministic algorithm. And the other is, the randomized case error conjecture that asks about, overflow k-competitive algorithm. So these are the big questions that we are after here too. And, so let's talk about, what is known about both of these conjectures. So, So let me give me just a very brief history of what's going on, because as you might imagine, there is actually a multitude of work on this problem, and I don't have time to really present it in any meaningful manner. So in terms of deterministic case error problem, then the conjecture that you can hope for, k-competitiveness was already put forward in the paper by Manasseh et al. In 88, but they didn't provide any general case error algorithm. They only had some indications to believe that this is the right answer. And, it took a while before, the first algorithm whose competitiveness depends only on K emerged. And as you can see, this competitiveness is quite large. It's actually exponential in K. So it seems to be very far off from, what we hope is correct. But shortly thereafter, there was a breakthrough paper by Kustupets and Papadimitriou, who showed that actually you can get an deterministic algorithm whose competitiveness is 2K minus 1 only. So clearly, here, we are done up to a factor of 2. And in fact, for some special cases of the problem, for instance, when the metric comes from a tree metric, we know that k is actually the right answer. So, we are, the state of affairs is pretty good here already. So how about the randomized case error problem? So, in case of the randomized algorithm, there was really a lot of work on various special variants of this problem. In particular now, quite recently, we learned that you can get an O of log K competitive algorithm for an extension of the caching problem called waiting paging problem. And this is the result of Banzhal et al. But, if you ask about the bound for general metric, then the best known result is just, the deterministic algorithm of Kostupas and Papadimitriou. So essentially, despite, it's intuitively obvious that we know how that randomization should help here, we have no idea how to take advantage of it. We don't understand how to use it here. And in fact, the state of the affairs is even more embarrassing than that, because we essentially don't know any little O of K guarantee for such simple metrics like a two-level tree or a line. So really, despite a lot of effort, the state of the affairs is not very promising here. So, you know, so once you look at this, you start to wonder, maybe, this bold conjecture that we are able to get, O of log k competitiveness is just, it's just too far reaching and it's really too optimistic. So maybe, maybe actually k is a bound here. So, so why are we optimistic about, getting O of log k? Well, there is no good reason, but we are. And, the result that I want to present to you today gives you actually some hope that maybe, this polylog competitiveness is not that much far, that far-fetched after all. So what we do, we present an algorithm for the general K-server problem, the randomized algorithm for the general K-server problem, that is, polylog competitiveness, polylog competitive. But of course, the catch here is that this polylog depends on K and N, so the number of points. So as long as the number of points is, sub-exponential in K, then we are improving over this 2K minus 1 bound. But in general, these two bounds are incomparable. Okay, so there is this dependence on I. So this is the result. So let me just proceed to explaining to you while giving you some idea how this kind of result can be obtained. So clearly, when you look at the state of the affairs, the history of the problem and what people struggled with, then it's pretty clear to everyone that sort of the hard part here seems to be dealing with an arbitrary, arbitrary metric, okay? Because, if metric is uniform, we know what to do. We know exactly what to do. So sort of the guiding principle of what we'll be doing here is, we will try to trade the complexity of the underlying metric, we will for the complexity of the problem we are solving. So what do I mean by that? What we will try to do, we will try to reduce the K-server problem over an arbitrary metric to a different, more difficult problem, but over a very simple metric, namely the uniform one, okay? So how can we do this kind of reduction? So how can we go about that? This reduction comes essentially in two big steps. So the first step, has something to do with so-called HST metrics. So what is an alpha HST metric is? It is a metric that is induced on the leaves of the following, type of a tree. So this tree is a level tree, and all the edges on the first level have length 1, all the edges on the second level have length alpha, all the edges on the third level have length alpha squared, and we have this kind of exponential growth at a rate of alpha for each of this level. So any metric that is induced on the leaves of such a tree will be an alpha HST metric. And the reason why we bring up this quite bizarrely looking metric is that actually there is a well-known beautiful theorem that tells us that that actually as long as we are okay with losing a factor of alpha times log n, then any metric on n points can be embedded into this kind of metric. So essentially, if you want to get an algorithm for the K-server problem for general metrics, and we are willing to pay this alpha log n factor in our competitiveness, then we can just constrain ourselves from now on just to alpha HST matrices. Okay? So because whenever we get an algorithm for this kind of metrics, it will immediately give us an algorithm for general metric here. Okay? So that's the first step. And so from now on, we just look at alpha HST metrics. So now, to understand the second step, we have to just take a look at, how a solution to a K-server looks like on an alpha HST, okay? So clearly, by definition of the metric, we have, that both requests and servers reside in the leaves of this tree. And, if you observe a K-server solution, then, if you look just at the trees, then, the process that will emerge there, sort of the way these servers are moving around here, might be very difficult and not really, easy to grasp. So what we will try to do instead to sort of understand what's going on a bit better, we will try to view this, complicated process on leaves as a process that is generated by relatively simple processes happening for each of the internal nodes. Okay, so we just try to break down this complicated process into simple processes that are happening for every internal node. So so this might be a bit mysterious. What do I mean by that? So let's tread slowly here. So in particular, so let's focus our attention on one particular internal node, let's say the root, okay, and let's look at what does this root C when he just, you know, constrains himself to his local neighborhood. So, you know, in his local neighborhood, he does not see anything except, you know, its children. So it particularly doesn't see the leaves. And, you know, what's going on there from his point of view? So, well, he doesn't see where the requests arrive, to which leaves the requests arrive. He just sees to which, you know, subtree corresponding to his children, well, this request shows up. Yeah? So we, if there is a request, well, somewhere in the, you know, in the subtree corresponding to the child, he only knows that, you know, there is a request corresponding to this child, and that's all that it sees. And similarly, you know, it doesn't see, you know, where the server exactly are located. All it sees is just, you know, how many servers are in each of the respective subtrees. So from his local point of view, he only sees this, you know, configurations when, you know, just assign number of servers to each of the to each of his child subtrees. And, well, in particular, you know, whenever there is a movement of servers around, well, he doesn't see anything of this movement as long as, you know, this movement does not, you know, move servers well between different different subtrees. Okay, so this is the local view of the root. And now we're wondering, now, what does this root see when he observes an optimal solution on the K server? Okay, well, what it will see is that, you know, there will be some dynamic emerging from, you know, from this configuration he's seeing. Namely, there will be like sort of two conflicting processes happening. So on one hand, you know, what will be happening is that the trees that tend to get a lot of requests will also tend to get more more servers there, because it will make, you know, taking care of this request easier. But on the other hand, of course, you know, the number of servers is fixed, so we cannot just, you know, give a lot of servers to every tree. And also moving servers around is expensive. So there will be some balancing act that will try to, you know, to just decide which are the trees that need most, you know, most of the resources. So we see that, you know, we will have these two conflicting goals. And now when we want to actually recover a good, you know, a good solution to the K-server problem, we will try to, you know, set up an algorithm that will try to guess what would be the best assignment of servers throughout the time. So we will try to, you know, to capture this kind of well, algorithmic task as an algorithm, as some particular algorithmic problem. And when you try to do that, then, you know, the problem you are likely to end up with is so-called the allocation problem, which is the third and last of the problems I want to introduce today. Okay. And by the way, I should mention that, you know, that like this general approach was pioneered here by, you know, Kote and Meyerson and Poplavsky. And in particular, they were the first to introduce this allocation problem in the context of the K-server problem. Okay. So what is the allocation problem? So in the allocation problem, well, you can think it that this is a job of some manager that oversees, you know, well, taking care of some projects, you know, well, by some team of, you know, of workers in a couple of offices. So the setup here is that we have a delocations over a uniform metric now. So the metric is uniform again. And now, you know, well, we have K servers or workers. And now it will actually make sense to have more than one worker at a given location. Okay? And now, you know, the game that is played is as follows. So in each round, we get a request. So the request is just, you know, what it consists of. Well, it consists of a location to which it corresponds to. And also, you know, together with this location, we are presented with k plus one values that are non-increasing. So there is, you know, st0 up to stk. And the meaning of these numbers is, you know, stj is just the cost of completing the project that's happening at this, you know, requested location if we have exactly j workers there. Okay? So essentially, you know, what's going on in each round, so, you know, the manager, whenever he sees the, you know, the request and the corresponding service costs, he has to decide, you know, whether I want to move some workers around, and, you know, any moving of workers will cause a move cost. And then once he says, okay, I'm done now, then, you know, we just look at the location that was, you know, well, that was requested, and we pay the service cost, well, given by the respective value of STJ. Okay, so here, you know, maybe seeing this request at first location, he decides to, well, to move, you know, to move two workers there, and now he says, I'm done, and he pays the cost of ST3. As a service cost here, okay? And also he paid the move cost of moving two servers. So this is the game that we are playing once again in online setting, and our goal now is to play this game in such a way that we will minimize the sum of the move cost and the service cost here, okay? So this is the problem. And note, you know, that I mentioned that, at some point I mentioned that, you know, the problem we'll end up working with will be a generalization of K-server problem, And indeed it is. So it's easy to see that if we just consider a special case of this problem in which, you know, the requests are of the form that you pay infinity service cost if there is no server at the location and zero service cost whenever there's at least one server at the location, then what we will recover here is exactly, you know, caching problem, which is the case server on the uniform metric. But of course, you know, we see that allocation problem is much more general than that. And sort of that will be the price we will be paying. And just one thing to note. So one thing that I ignored here, that actually, you know, to make this problem useful to us, I'm sorry, we have to generalize it slightly. Namely, we also, you know, well, in addition to all of, you know, the service costs and the requests, we also should allow the number of available workers to change over time. So like in each round, we also are told, okay, this round, you have only this many workers, you know, available to you. So if you have more than that, you have to return some of them back to the headquarters, or, you know, if you have less than that, then you will get some free workers here, okay? But I will ignore this. I will ignore this this part in this talk. So this is the problem we are interested in, and, you know, the question is, you know, why do we care about this problem? Well, and the reason why we care is the problem because, like Kote et al. Showed that if you are able to get a good enough algorithm for this allocation problem, then it allows you to get, you know, well, what we are looking for, namely a polylogarithmic competitive algorithm for the k-server problem over general metric. So note here that this polylog depends on k and n, as we expect, but also it depends on delta, which is the aspect ratio of the underlying metric. So, well, this is the theorem, and essentially, you know, well, what it means is that, you know, from now on, all we really need to care about is just, you know, finding the good enough algorithm for the allocation problem. So note that now we have a problem over a uniform metric, but, well, it seems to be slightly more difficult than the original problem we were dealing with. And so this is the theorem that, you know, Kote et al. Proved, and also they sort of made the first step, and they showed that, you know, there indeed exists this good enough algorithm, at least if, you know, if your problem corresponds to exactly two locations. So d is equal to 2. And this, you know, doesn't really give us anything in general case. It only gives us some, algorithm for very special type of metrics. But this is the first step. So, well, all we have to do is just, you know, make the next step and just get, you know, the good enough algorithm for, you know, for the general case. So that's, you know, that's what we set out to do. And that's exactly where we failed. Because, you know, after quite a lot of effort, we realize that we don't know how to do that. Like, it seems to us that the problem, in the course of this reduction, the problem just that we ended up with just becomes too hard. We just don't know how to get this good enough guarantee for this, you know, for the problem that I just stated to you. So that's not good, yes, because, well, essentially it seems that, well, this is a dead end. So because we reduce a problem to another problem that we don't know how to solve, so that means, you know, that all the effort is wasted here. But, well, maybe it's not that bad. So let's try to recover. And sort of, so let's try to, you know, sort of to, yeah, to prolong the agony here. And let's try to, you know, okay, we don't know how to solve the, you know, the actual problem. So let's just try to look at some fractional relaxation of it, okay, and see what we can do there. So what kind of fractional relaxation can we consider here? Well, it's probably the, you know, the simplest possible fractional relaxation you could imagine. So what we will be doing, so, well, instead of keeping track of the actual integral configuration of the servers, what we will do, we'll just keep track of, you know, of some marginals. So we'll just keep track of marginal probabilities xij for any I and j, well, which is the probability that we have exactly j servers at location I, okay? So what kind of constraints we want to enforce here? Well, one type of constraints will just say that for any location I, this is indeed a probability distribution. So this xijs for a fixed I sum up to 1. And the second constraint will just say that, you know, if we sample independently the number of servers from each of these configurations, then the expected number of servers that we will get by this procedure will be exactly what it should be, namely k. Okay? And once we are dealing with a more general configurations, we have to extend the notion of service cost and move cost, and we do it in an absolutely natural manner. So we just look at the expected service cost, and we look at some, well, earth mover distance between configurations as they change. So now we have this fractional relaxation, you know, and the good news here is that, oh, actually for this relaxation, we know how to get this good enough algorithm. So far, so good. But, well, the problem is that this fractional relaxation, actually, well, we can't really use it to get the good solution for the integral case, because the problem is that this fractional relaxation actually has very bad integrality gap. So it has an integrality gap of omega of k. So, you know, there is no hope that we'll be able to get a rounding procedure that will always, well, give us a good enough solution for the integral case. So, well, we tried to do something and we got stuck again. So what to do now? So do we abandon this whole approach? Well, not really. So now, you know, the key observation that we have to make is that actually, you know, why do we even care about this allocation problem? Yes, like, we don't really want to solve this allocation problem. This is just some kind of proxy for what we really want to solve, namely the k-server problem. So we want to get an integral solution for the k-server problem, not necessarily the integral solution for the fractional problem, for the allocation problem. So once we realize that, then what we do, so this is the outline of our algorithm, what we do, well, we start from our solution for the fractional allocation problem, and then we, you know, extend the reduction of quota et al. To, well, to get out of this fractional allocation problem, a fractional solution to the k-server problem on the HST. So we get a solution that is fractional for k-server problem. But now we show that once you are dealing with a k-server problem, like fractional k-server problem on the HST, actually there is a simple rounding procedure that will give you, you know, the integral solution to the k-server problem on the HST, and will just incur some, you know, some acceptable overhead. So, well, so this is the way the algorithm works, and, you know, and it seems to work. So the question is, you know, where did the integrality gap go? Well, essentially what happened here is that, you know, once we are able to defer the rounding step to the moment when we deal with k-server problem and not the general allocation problem, then, you know, then for the configurations corresponding to the k-server problem, actually this integrality gap, well, is not present. It only is present for some configurations for the allocation problem. So in this way, you know, by being able to defer the step, we just, you know, got around this integrality gap, and we could get what we wanted. And let me just note that one thing that I omitted here is that, you know, as probably you noted, you know, the reduction of quota et al., it introduced also a dependency on the aspect ratio of the metric. And actually, we had a way of getting rid of that. So we are able to not get rid of this dependence. But I will not talk about this here. So this is the way our algorithm works. And, you know, and the remaining time I just want to spend on, you know, on giving you some glimpse of how this fractional allocation problem actually works like. Yes, because maybe it wasn't clear from the way I was explaining things, but actually this is the heart of our algorithm. Yes, like this is actually where the most non-trivial things, you know, are happening. So let me try to give you a glimpse of that here. So, well, I will do it, you know, I will give you this glimpse, well, just for a special case of the problem. So in the special case, you know, well, I will just assume that all the service cost vectors are of the form that you either have to pay, some cost CT for not having a server at location, and, you know, once we have at least one server at location, we just pay zero. So this special case corresponds to caching with renting, when we have a caching problem, in which, you know, whenever we have a request and we don't have a server there, we have an option of paying CT for just taking care of this particular request and not have to move the server. So not having to move the server. So this is the special case we will focus on here, and, you know, clearly once we are in the special case, then really it doesn't make sense to put more than one server at any given location. So we can assume that, you know, that all xij's for j bigger than one are just zero. And essentially, you know, once we are in the special case, you know, we can, you know, the complete description of the configuration is just given by saying, for instance, you know, what is the value of xi0 for every location, and xi0 is the probability of having no servers at location I. Because once we know this, we know what is the probability of having one server at location I, so we know everything we want to know. Okay? So this is the special case we will focus on, and also, just to get rid of corner cases, let me also assume that, you know, even though these probabilities xi0 are numbers between 0 and 1, they actually never are exactly 0 or are never exactly 1. They are always, you know, strictly between these two boundaries. Okay? So this is the special case we will be dealing with here. So I just, you know, I just reproduce it over here. And, you know, so the picture we should look at is something like this. So this, you know, this brown, volume corresponds to the volume of the server that we have at every given location, and xi0s are just the gaps that we have, you know, in each of the locations. So now, you know, so how the algorithm works now? How our algorithm works? So in each round t, it is presented with some request and some, you know, that corresponds to a location and some service cost vector. And, well, usually what I should just tell you is that, you know, if our old state was this, then our new state will be this. But that's not what I will do. What I will do instead, you know, the way our algorithm is defined is just it provides a way of evolving the old state into a new state via some, continuous process that depends on the request. So what will be just happening, you know, whenever we see, whenever a new round happens, you know, and we see the new request, then, you know, we will just set up some evolution of the current state that, you know, that along which our state will evolve for some period of time, and, you know, whatever it will evolve into will be our new state. So this evolution will be, you know, so this will be in infinitesimal is evolution, and it will be a two-step process. So what we will be doing is, you know, as a first step, we will have so-called rising step, in which we will just decrease the value of xit zero by the following quantity. So just to decipher what this quantity is, so note that, you know, xit zero is just the probability that we have zero servers at the requested location. And CT is just the penalty that we pay for not having a server location. So essentially what this expression is, it's proportional to the expected service cost that we will pay in current configuration. So what we are doing, we are trying to decrease the value of XIT zero by this quantity. So essentially we will try to reduce the service cost that we will incur. And we will do it proportionally to the service cost that we actually are likely to incur at this moment. So this is sort of like a gradient descent step here. So that's good because, you know, reducing the service cost is something we definitely want to do. But of course, the problem is that, you know, that this will make the state infeasible, yes, because we just we just put more volume into our system, but, you know, now we have to withdraw some volume to make the problem to make the solution feasible again. And the way we do it, we do it in the fixing step, and the way we do it is just by increasing each of xi zeros proportionally to the value of xi zero plus some additive factor. So we just do it, you know, we just do it infinitesimally as long as, you know, the volume, we have too much volume in the system. So sort of, you know, so sort of clearly, you know, by doing that we will make the system, the state feasible again. And the intuition behind this, you know, fixing step is that sort of like we do this withdrawal proportional to the xi zero because, you know, whenever we have a location that has, you know, almost full server there, we want to be very conservative with withdrawing volume from there. We are much more happy to, you know, to be more, you know, to be more courageous in withdrawal from a location that already have not that much server already. So this kind of withdrawal rule, it comes, you know, when if you are familiar with multiplicative weight update method, then this kind of withdrawal rule will be, you know, what you will get out of that. So this is the algorithm. So we just keep repeating this, you know, these steps for some period of time. And now the question is, you know, how to analyze it. So how to prove some competitiveness here. So I want you to give you an example. Actually, the competitive analysis of this problem is quite simple. And, you know, it's based on having some potential. So it's a potential based argument. So what our potential is? Well, our potential is this expression written over there. So this expression depends on two things: on the configuration of the algorithm, and the configuration of some fixed optimal solution. Yeah? So we don't know; our algorithm doesn't know what the solution is, but, you know, there is some fixed optimal solution, and we just want to measure some, you know, some distance of our configuration from the configuration of this optimal solution. So to just decipher what this, you know, what this potential is. Well, note that here, essentially, like phi is just the sum of, you know, contributions of each particular location, and each particular location L, what it contributes is, you know, it contributes zero if the optimal solution at a given time has a server at I. So at all the locations that, you know, that the optimal solution has a server, the contribution of this location to the potential is always zero, no matter whether we have server there or not. And now, on the other hand, if optimal solution does not have a server at the location, then this, you know, then this contribution is logarithmic, you know, given by this expression. So just to decipher what this expression is, yes. So it's over there. So this is an example graph of it. So what will happen is that, you know, so this expression decreases as xi zero grows. So if xi zero is one, then this logarithm just evaluates to zero, and, you know, if xi0 is 0, which corresponds to having a server at location I, then this expression is something that is O of log k. Okay? And no, and we have everything in between for fractional values of xi0 as the logarithm function dictates. Okay? So, you know, for those of you that are sort of familiar, you can see that there is some similarity here between, you know, relative entropy and, you know, and this potential. The similarity is not exact, but sort of the feeling is sort of the same. Okay, So this is our potential.
And now, you know, how can we use it to prove the competitiveness? So,
so assume we want to establish O of log K competitiveness of our algorithm. And so, you know, as the potential based arguments go, all we have to show is that, you know, at every given throughout the whole execution of the algorithm, the following inequality is, you know, differential inequality is preserved. And, you know, just to get rid of some, you know, of too much of expressions, let me just, you know, prove to you that this inequality holds in a special case where this corresponds to caching, when all the, you know, all the costs for not having a service are actually infinity. So we essentially, what happens there, that we never want to pay any service costs, so we always make sure that we don't pay any service costs at all. So then, you know, this inequality that we have to show, it just simplifies to the following thing. And, you know, whatever we show, this will be a proof of O of log K competitiveness for caching problem. Okay, so how can we show this inequality here? Well, what we do, well, so we just fix some rant of our algorithm that corresponds to, you know, to a request being at location IT. And we'll just divide, you know, we'll just divide this around the way what algorithm and optimal solution does into three stages. So in the first stage, you know, we just look, you know, whether opt moves or not. So opt only moves if he doesn't have a server at IT already. And, you know, if he doesn't have a server at IT already, then he will move one server there from some location I prime. So how is it, well, how does this move affect our inequality? Well, clearly, you know, our algorithm doesn't move, so the change of the movement of algorithm is zero here. And clearly, just optimum solution just moved one server, so delta move opt is just one. And now, what is the change in the potential? Well, in the worst case, what will happen is that, like, once we withdraw a server from location I prime, well, then this location will start to contribute something to the potential. But, you know, no matter what the value of xi prime 0 is, in the worst case, it will be just some, you know, O of log k factor. So we know that in the worst case, you know, no matter from which location the optimum will withdraw the servers, this will be at most that other factor. So we see that, you know, on the right we have O of log k, and on the left we have O of log k, so everything works out. Okay? So this step is okay. Now, for the second stage, well, what happens is that the algorithm, well, tries to decrease the value of xit0. And since it wants to have a zero service cost, then essentially it sets xit0 to zero. Okay? So that's what it does. So how does it reflect in our inequality? So, well, clearly, optimum doesn't move, so we don't have to worry about that. Also, the potential also doesn't change, because we know that opt has to have a server to location it. And we know that locations that have, or opt have a server, they don't contribute anything to the potential. So nothing changes here. The only thing that changes is sort of the move cost, because we brought some volume to the location IT. But, well, we can actually charge this increase in the volume to the withdrawal step, because, you know, whatever we bring here, we'll have to withdraw in the next step. So we will just, you know, we'll just charge this increase to the withdrawal in the next step. So we don't have to worry about this here. Okay, so this stage is okay. And now there is only one stage left, well, in which the algorithm withdraws the volume from the locations. And remember, the way it happens is that, like, as long as the state is infeasible, so it has too much volume, we just increase each xi0 proportionally to the xi0 plus 1 over k. Okay? So what's happening? So once again, opt doesn't move, so we don't have to care about it. So what is the move cost of the algorithm? Well, each location contributes, you know, this factor of xi0 plus 1k times the proportionality factor d tau. And when we sum it up, then we will see that, you know, this 1 over k will sum up to n over k, clearly. And also, you know, this xi0s, they will sum up to n minus k. And why is it so? Well, it is so because we know that if state is, what does it mean that the state is infeasible? It means that, you know, the sum of xi0 is too small. So it's actually strictly smaller than n minus k. So we use here to upper bound our move cost by this quantity. And now, well, all that remains to do is just, you know, the estimate what is the change in the potential once we withdraw. So, well, what the change in the potential is? Well, so we just sum over all the locations. And, you know, and what we have here, well, we just look at the derivative of our potential and, you know, times the change in each of the variables. And, you know, when you do the math, when you take this derivative, then the magic happens, and actually each of the terms will be exactly, well, equal to one. Because, of course, this is the way it was chosen to, so this is not a coincidence, but sort of a nice fact. So we see that the change, total change in the potential is just the sum. It's, well, we will get some minus, and you know, and this is, you know, just the sum over all locations of, you know, of the xi zero star.
So this is just describes the
configuration of the optimal solution. And well, we know what this has to sum up to. It has to sum up to exactly n minus k. So we see that, you know, the change in the potential is minus 2 well, times n minus k. And now, you know, once we want to compare these two things, the move cost and the change in the potential, and you know, it's an easy exercise to see that indeed, you know, these two quantities work the way we want them. So essentially, that the sum of change in the potential and the change and the move cost is, you know, at most zero, so the inequality is preserved. And this is, and what we use here is the fact, so to have this inequality hold, we have to use the fact that n is at least k plus 1. Yes, because if it's exactly k, then the problem is not interesting anymore. So we assume that n is always strictly bigger than k. Okay, so that's all. That's the whole analysis. And, you know, just extending this analysis to the, you know, to the case when the CT can be actually arbitrary, or when xi zeros can be exactly 0 or exactly 1 is very easy. What is not that easy is actually, you know, extending this algorithm to be able to handle the general cost vectors. Yeah? So there is some natural way of extending this algorithm to general cost vectors, but you know, the first natural extension will not work. There will be some difficulties. So you have to get some further ideas to make everything work. But well, it can be done, and please see the paper for details.
So yeah. So this is it. So let me just conclude and state some open problems.
So. Well, what happened here is like we provide the first polylog competitive algorithm for the k-server problem. And you know,
the grand challenge and natural question, open question here is, you know, can we finally settle this k-server conjecture? Yes. So, you know, either by proving, you know, the right upper bounds, or maybe finally improving the lower bounds, you know, even by something small. It would be very interesting.
And you know, and maybe a less ambitious challenge but still very interesting would be just, you know, to decide whether, you know, well, either get rid of the dependence on n. Or actually, maybe prove that it's necessary. Yeah? So, you know, having a lower bound that tells you that, you know, that you have to have some, you know, well, log star n dependence on the on n in your competitiveness, it would be very interesting, because I think the general belief is that there should be no dependence on n at all. So that would be very interesting. So this is these are questions regarding the k-server problem. But in general, sort of, you know, the one thing that I think is very important in the grand theme of dealing with uncertainty in optimization is that actually, I'm not exactly sure whether, you know, stochastic model or online model are the right models to begin with. So I think that still, you know, sometimes these models work out, but I think these are not the ultimate best models that we could have. And you know, the big open problem here is actually like to find some, you know, meaningful model that will, on one hand, allow us to get, you know, well, allow us to get any theoretical result, but then it will also correspond quite well to what's happening in the reality. Okay, thank you.